Loreena McKennitt shares the story of how Alfred Lord Tennyson's poem, The Lady of Shalott, became a song on her 1991 album, The Visit. Classic poetry and books are often used as inspiration for modern songs. I'm going to share why I wrote a song inspired by Anne of Green Gables. It's on Pub Songs and Stories, show number 245. Welcome to Pub Songs and Stories. This is the virtual public house for musicians to share the stories and inspiration behind their music with your host, Marc Gunn. Subscribe to the podcast at pubsong.com. Greetings, my friends, and happy holidays. Merry Christmas to you, or whatever you celebrate. I hope you're having a great holiday season. It's already December, and I'm feeling the pressure of the holidays coming up. I have some podcasts to finish up. I have the Celtic Top 20 for the Irish and Celtic Music podcast that's coming at the end of the year, plus some Christmas podcasts that I'm doing. My Celtic Christmas podcast is coming along beautifully. Actually, the Celtic Christmas playlist is coming along beautifully. So if you don't know, I host multiple other podcasts. The Irish and Celtic Music podcast is my flagship one, but I also do the Celtic Christmas podcast. And over the past 15 years or whatever since I've been doing it, that show was a music podcast where I play. It's just like the Irish and Celtic Music podcast. But one of the problems I found with Christmas music is that most of it is copyrighted, which makes for a very limited selection of Christmas music that I could play, which is why I finally decided I was going to discontinue that style, the music podcast, for public consumption at least. And instead, I'm just going to do these short little features on artists. At least that's how I'm starting it. We'll see how it evolves in the future. I think for this year, it's going to be the same. I'm thinking next year, I might try to do it more like I do with this show, where I get, you know, Christmas stories from people, because I think that'd be a little even more interesting. But right now, it's just, you know, sort of reviews of Celtic musicians who have Christmas music. Now, the coolest part about it, though, is that it allows me to focus on the playlists. You know, I've been doing Celtic Christmas playlists on Spotify for many years now, and I have several that are doing pretty well. And now I get to focus that a little bit more in that direction. And the Patreon page for the Celtic Christmas podcast is centered around playlists now. And that's the way it's going to be in the future. So very excited about that change. And it's coming along, like I said, it's coming along beautifully. So thanks, especially to all those people who are supporting that Celtic Christmas Patreon page, because it does make it happen. I was about to discontinue it altogether, and when I came up with a new spin on how to promote these artists that have Christmas music. Speaking of Patreon, though, I want to thank my gunrunners on Patreon. Thanks to our newest patrons, Expat Fledgling, Crory Dempsey, Ryan and Kelly Melville, and John Moda. I really appreciate everyone's support over on Patreon. That is, again, the number one way of supporting musicians and artists and creative type people is by supporting something like Patreon, because it means for just $5 a month, you can get some cool stuff and also support things like this podcast. And all my patrons over there are the reason this show continues to grow and I will continue it on into the future. So thank you so much. I have a new Christmas single that is out. In fact, it's not just a Christmas single. It's a Hobbit Christmas single. The song is called Yuletide. It was written by my friend Nancy Flynn. I'm going to talk about it on the next show. You can join the Gunrunners Club on Patreon to download it now. And again, stick around for the next show. I'll talk more about that. And what are you doing while listening to Pub Songs and Stories? I'd love your thoughts and feedback. So take a picture of yourself or where you are or what one of those stories reminds you of and post it on social media. Use the hashtag PubStories so I can find it and share your story. Upcoming shows. Coffee with the Celtfather has just two more shows left for the season. That is our December 8th and December 15th. And then I have a Celtfather Live on December 16th that I'm planning. So come join me for those. Tickets have not gone on sale for the Celtfather Live, and I'm debating whether I'm going to have them. I think this might be one where I'm going to open it up to everyone and no tickets. Yeah, I think that sounds nice. So if you'd like to join it, mark your calendars. And if you would like to support me and buy a ticket anyways, you can do that as well. Let's get on with some stories. Today I have the story of the Lady of Shalott. So Arthurian mythology shows up a lot in my life, whether it's the Chalice Well that accidentally became a part of the Brobdingnagian Bards logo, or my very first Renaissance festival, Excalibur Fantasy Faire. I love stories about life during the time of Camelot. So I guess I wasn't very surprised that I fell in love with Loreena McKennitt's song Lady of Shalott 30 years ago. Her song was written based on a poem by Alfred Lord Tennyson, and I have my own connection to it too, which I'll tell you a bit more about in a moment. But first, I'm extremely pleased to have Loreena McKennitt share a story about how and why the Lady of Shalott also became a song for her. In September, she re-released a 30th anniversary edition of her 1991 album, The Visit. The album has sold more than 2 million copies. It features all of the original songs remastered, plus a bunch of live performances, alternate mixes, and even some interviews she's done on the album. And I'll let her tell you a little story about the Lady of Shalott. Here's Loreena McKennitt.
I've spent some glorious days in the English countryside over the years, enjoying the lyricism of the landscape, as well as some of this country's literary greats. When I was looking for a poem which had some possible connection to the Celts, no matter how tangential, I came across the poem The Lady of Shalott by Lord Alfred Tennyson. Published in the 1830s, it came from a time when people had time to compose and listen to long stories. I was struck by the imagery as well as the narrative. My quest was then to evoke that pastoral picture captured in Tennyson's poem, and which I myself had been privileged to witness off and on during the 1980s. I wanted to paint the average folk with the accordion texture and create lyrical lines which would represent the landscape. The metronome-like quality of the balalaika was intended to emulate the canter of Sir Lancelot's horse, which is depicted in the narrative of the song, and which would have been the mode of transportation in Tennyson's day. Some of the imagery which spoke to me the most was actually that of the reapers reaping early, piling sheaves well into the evening and below the gaze of the moon. I still see this activity in the area where I live in southern Ontario, where there are Mennonite and Amish living and farming in 19th century ways. Having grown up myself around a farm and being familiar with some level of manual labor, I can relate to that sense of place and purpose, the rhythms of the seasons, sometimes even the rhythm of the task you're doing, sometimes in beautiful outdoor settings, and the feeling you are one with your manual task, who you are and what you are doing, how it grounds you to the earth and your own survival. Of course, it can be easy to romanticize these kinds of things, and I'm well familiar with the less comfortable and scenic version of farming life. At the same time, it is an analog experience of connection and belonging no kind of contemporary technology could ever replicate. And I'm grateful to have had the opportunity to creatively work with a poem like this and share it with so many people around the world.
Sheaves and our planetary, listening whispers, 'tis the fairy, the horses on her eve she's tied to look down to Camelot. She knows not what the curse may be, so she leaves steadily.
That, of course, was Loreena McKennitt with The Lady of Shalott. It was from a live recording at the Galliard Center in 2016, and it's from The Visit, the definitive edition that was just released back in September. You can find out more about Loreena McKennitt at loreenamckennitt.com. That's with two T's at the end. I screwed that up for years when I was doing promotion for the Irish and Celtic Music podcast, or the Celtic Music magazine back in the day. You'll also find her music all over streaming. The story was released along with other stories as promo for The Visit, the definitive edition. So you can actually find more stories like that about her songs on streaming if you get a chance to check it out. I gotta say, I love her description of this song, though. I feel like she beautifully captured the imagery of the pastoral English countryside. In the fall of 2019, McKennitt put her career on hold to place more time and attention on civic matters and climate change, while also advocating for stronger legislation to protect artists' rights and encouraging people to buy their music directly from the artists whenever possible. And that's just fantastic. We really do need more people to work on the climate renaissance. So I would want my own input into that, too. So I was very, very pleased when I saw what McKennitt was doing over the past few years. So, hey, if you enjoyed this, then support what you love. The musicians on this podcast are happy to share their music freely with you. You can find our music on streaming music sites, but streaming is a way to sample the music. If you hear something you love, these artists need your support. Please visit the websites, sign up to their mailing list, and buy something. The holiday season is here, so if you're looking for gifts, why not a classical physical CD? I know fewer people are buying CDs these days, but that doesn't mean it won't be a great gift for someone. So if that's not good enough, you can also get shirts, stickers, pens, songbooks, jewelry, or even digital downloads for you or a friend. Your purchase allows musicians to keep making music. And if you're not into the physical stuff, again, many artists accept tips or are on Patreon. So please support the arts. If this show made you happy, you can also join my Gunrunners Club on Patreon. Your support pays for the production and promotion of my music and this podcast. And if you have questions or comments, drop me an email and you can save 15% with an annual membership. And, you know, I am kind of curious. It's the holiday season. I was really kind of curious what kind of gifts are you giving? Drop me an email, sing@pubsong.net. You'll get an autoresponder, just so you know, which will also give you some freebies and help you to easily sign up to this mailing list. And you'll also get a little ebook of 10 songs that you'll love to sing. But mostly, I just want your feedback. I would really love to know what you think of what kind of gifts you like to give. One of the thoughts, my thoughts here is because, you know, Well, I think classical physical CDs are still something that some people really would like to have. I also know that many of us, me included, have trouble actually playing physical CDs. It's not an easy medium to work with anymore. So perhaps there's something else that we could offer instead. Let me know. sing@pubsong.net. It's now the time for a story of dreamers and that Anne girl. So before I fell in love with Loreena McKennitt's song, I'd already fallen in love with the Lady of Shalott, and that was because of a TV miniseries called Anne of Green Gables. The show is based on the books by Lucy Maud Montgomery. There's a wonderful scene in the series where Anne Shirley and some friends reenact the story of the Lady of Shalott using a boat. So Anne is lying in the boat with flowers across her chest. Her friends push her out into the river as she recites the poem, and the boat slowly glides downstream before it springs a leak. She sits up and tries her best to scoop water out of the sinking boat. Eventually, she is rescued at a bridge by her love interest, the dashing Gilbert Blythe. My mom introduced me to the VHS of the miniseries during my senior year of high school, and I don't know why the show resonated so much with me. Maybe it had to do with the beautiful imagery of Prince Edward Island and the wild imagination and creativity of that Anne girl, which I really loved. She was so creative and so much great imagination. I just loved that. And it still delights me to this day, though I haven't seen the show in probably a decade. I used to watch it all the time. In college, I read all of Montgomery's books and even devoured a book of poetry by her. And I remember one poem resonated a lot at the time, but I can't for the life of me remember what it was. And I kind of wonder if it was one of those, you know, those moments, you know, a poem where you read a poem and you're like, that is life in it, encapsulated right there. And now, of course, times change and it's just not as, doesn't suit me nearly as much. So whatever the case, I absolutely loved the Montgomery's work. So by 2004, Anne of Green Gables was sort of a comfort show for me. I used to watch shows on repeat while I worked, and this one regularly made it into rotation for me. One evening I was watching it, I paused the show and I picked up the auto harp and I wrote a tribute to dreamers like Anne. The song was sadly short-lived at my live shows. I was still playing with the Brobdingnagian Bards, I think, when I wrote it, so it didn't quite fit our music. But I eventually did record it on a CD called A Tribute to Love, and I'm going to play it for you right now. Here's to the dreamers and the children all alone. Imaginations evoke a world of a happy home. A wild cherry tree to bed down late at night, or a strong pavilion will carry you to the growing light. Arm in arm, they'll ride by seaside while our dreams drift in with the rising tide. Here's to the orphans whose dreams are ever aloof. Imaginations are only shadowed by the truth. They sail across the ocean, drift up through the trees, through the white way of delight. Flowers bloom with the coming spring. Arm in arm, ride by seaside while our dreams drift in with the rising tide. While our dreams drift in with the rising tide, the rising tide, oh, the rising tide. Thanks so much. I hope you enjoyed that song and this entire show. Again, next week I'm going to have a Celtic Christmas special. And one final question I want to know is, what song would you like to hear more about in the future? I'm starting to plan 2022, and I would love your feedback. So drop me a line. I'll talk to you later. Sláinte. Pub Songs Podcast is produced by Marc Gunn. The show is edited by Mitchell Peterson with graphics by Miranda Nelson Designs. You can subscribe and listen wherever you find podcasts. You can also subscribe to my mailing list. You will get regular updates of new music, podcasts, special offers, and you'll get 21 songs for free. Welcome to the pub at pubsong.com.